hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Well, I'm utterly humbled to be in front of all of you and also to be with this very distinguished group of intellectuals and scholars and very, very talented group. Now I want to start with a very personal note, but I will also try to connect it to my talk. Speaking of ideas and creativity and imagination, 25th of January, 7 years ago, a group of young Egyptians, they decided to go to a place, to a public place, Tahrir Square, and they were trying to make something good for their country. They were full of hope. I'm not sure about what is happening now, but I think it was a great historical moment in the contemporary history of Egypt. And again, it was because of the interrelation between people and places, which is the thing that I'm really excited about here. And I'm not excited about it as only to observe it, but also the whole concept of learning, how to learn from looking at people and places. And I will relate this to the contemporary narrative, the contemporary tale of Doha. Can you use your question? Thank you. So, it seems to me that the whole concept of learning is absolutely legitimate for any city. But the condition here is that in the process of learning, you don't imitate. You see the qualities. You look at qualities as opposed to you look at image. So I think I want to use one of the very interesting examples that I think it's definitely a good evidence of the meaning of learning from other places. And I'm talking here about Pompidou Center, the very famous cultural center in Paris. I'm not that much into the beautiful architecture and the design and the whole story of the building that literally changed the architecture, the modern architectural movement. But I'm more excited about how to learn from the open space in front of the cultural center and how people sort of claim space within the city and create a wonderful relation between people and the cultural center. So learning from cities is important. And in this sense, it seems to me that it's not necessary to say Doha is not Paris or Doha is not Dubai. I am more excited about Doha is Doha. How Doha has grown to create its own story. How Doha has grown to create its own narrative. Learning from leaders also is very, very important. And I'm not doing this on a rhetoric, flattering kind of approach, but I'm talking about a sort of a historical moment in the contemporary history of Qatar, which has qualitatively changed the approach, the conceptual agenda for the progress and development of the country. Here you see a very interesting statement by Sheikh Hamouza, where she's saying it's about time to move from the typical status of the Middle East and the Arab as consumers of knowledge to producers of knowledge. So a different kind of identity to the Gulf, to the Middle East, and also to Qatar. Learning also from leaders, Sheikh Tamim in his speech at the United Nations. And for the very first time in the narrative of Gulf cities, you're talking about people. But when he elaborated on his perception of people, he meant both locals and expats. So a different again perception and approach to what do we mean by people engaged in the city or living in the city. And we need also to learn from intellectuals and scholars. And I would stop here in front of the work of Jane Jacobs and her beautiful, beautiful book, Death and Life of Great American Cities. She is describing cities almost 60 years ago, saying that the good city is the one that will provide something for everybody, and also everybody has a share in the creation of the city. So two beautiful conditions. And we have a lot of oil in the Gulf. Incredible financial resources. But quickly, we fall into the trap of regional competition to build bigger and higher, and we had this even in the most sacred parts of the Gulf. This is my book, it's in Arabic, but it's criticizing the urban movement around the urban development around the Mecca, around Kaaba, and how we also resort to the concept of towers and sort of hurt the spirituality of the place. And then we realize that we are approaching a different paradigm, the post-carbon paradigm. It's really coming, not only because of the depletion of oil, but also the incredible decrease in prices and the environmental movements, and also new excellent resources, environmentally correct resources coming and feeding us. A lot of books are coming now in the direction of knowledge-based urban development, and I did participate in most of these books, but the final book, Knowledge-Based Urban Development in the Middle East, this is my book, and it will be in the market in the coming months. Half of the book is about Qatar and the experience of Qatar and how Qatar is moving towards this new paradigm in terms of urban development and city growth. Now let me put you in a sort of a scale here, because also we need to understand that the narrative of Qatar is relatively short if you compare it to Paris, for instance. This is Doha in 1937, Doha in the red frame. And if you trace this frame, you will see Doha now, and you can see the relation between the pace of development within 6 or 7 decades. Outstanding, outstanding. But this is the kind of development that would need us to pose and ask questions to see if we are on the right track or not. And therefore, we started to have a sort of principles and values that would guide us in according to the learning experience that we had. Values and principles related to engaging people, celebrating cultural diversity, inclusive public spaces, vibrant streets, promote the culture of walking, how to appreciate the environment, and how also to inspire and educate people via architecture and urbanism. Cultural diversity should be seen as an asset rather than creating barriers between people. So how this is also how the city spaces and places are sort of demonstrating this and suggesting this. The first level to achieve this is what we call it the planning level. So for the very first time in the history of Qatar, we have now a Qatar National Master Plan, which is covering the whole of Qatar, the main 8 municipalities. And each of those municipalities now, they have a vision, they have a strategy, they have some goals related to their potentials, related to their challenges, and it's created all the way up to the zoning level and land uses level. And then particularly when it comes to Doha, we did introduce the concept also of urban centers to decentralize the typical kind of sprawled pace of urbanism that was very typical in the Gulf, but we are moving more towards compacted level of urbanism. So you have different centers, urban centers with all the required facilities, distributed in a very balanced way throughout the overall fabric of the city. Another interesting approach is related to the transit-oriented development. We need to abandon our cars. We need to abandon our Land Cruisers and move to another culture, the culture of using public transportation, the culture of walking, the culture of using bikes. So we know the values of this, but then it's not only about having public transportation or having streets, but how to prepare those streets to encourage people to walk and enjoy the act of walking or riding their bicycles or using public transportation. The metro is helping us a lot, but what is interesting in our approach is also that we related the different station of the metro to all of the urban centers. So each metro station is kind of the center part of an urban center. So people will have public spaces, they will have commercial activities, mixed-use activities. So each station is going to be a hub of development. Another interesting thing about the metro in Qatar, that it's in metropolitan Doha, that it's covering the whole city. It's a four lines in different direction, going across the whole city from north to south and from east to west. And therefore we ended up with a sort of, the main concept that is are reflected in the overall planning, urban centers, transit-oriented development, and then green connectivity via people-oriented streets rather than typical highways and roads. Those are the kind of streets that are scattered all over the place, but these are not our models now. We are moving now to models, again, learning from other cities. This is Maria Helfer Strasse in Vienna, the kind of street that is 90% of the street is dedicated for people, walking, celebrating, eating, drinking, socializing. Those are our models now. Those are the kind of lessons that we learn from other cities around the world. Sorry, excuse me. And we are trying to do this in Doha, to introduce the public transportation, to transform the streets into a more green kind of connections between different destinations, and also to insert the notion of small gardens and public spaces and places for kids and families. And also on the level of architecture and project and developments, we insert and encourage this notion of a more knowledge urban and knowledge-based urbanist, either in the new projects and also how we are dealing with our heritage. And I will elaborate on this in a minute. So this is the case of Education City, for instance. And the beautiful thing about Education City is that the whole effort is geared towards transforming the city into a place extremely connected to the rest of Doha. And you have a lot of activities that gear towards the community, even more geared towards the students. You have parks, you have the mosque, you have the equestrian facilities, you have some shoppings too. So the knowledge is sort of disseminated to the community via their typical kind of visits, in addition to the National Library, which is also sort of literally sucking people inside the building and inviting people to go into the experience of reading and gaining knowledge. The stadiums, and my brother and close friend Ibrahim would elaborate on that, but I want to focus on a single terminology that Qatar was so unique to insert in the whole notion of sports events, the term legacy, that we are thinking not only about the event, but the post-event. And even Sheikh Tamim repeatedly said that all what we are doing to host the event is absolutely interesting and needed, but we are targeting all of this to the people. And again, the people here means this mix that I talked about, locals and expatriates. And what is interesting also that each of those stadiums within the overall Qatar National Master Plan is becoming a sort of catalyst for development that would create a sort of a context around it rather than to be a sort of an independent sports facility.